All right, let's get started. So good day, everyone. My name is Marie Muldowney, and I'm the Managing Director of CSI at Moody's Analytics. I'm pleased to welcome you to this webinar, Breaking into the Financial Services Industry. If you're interested in a career in financial services, this webinar will provide insight into how to navigate your way successfully into a role. And if you're wondering whether a role in financial services is even for you, then this webinar will serve to give you an idea of the various roles that you can play in financial services. You can be client-facing, providing advice to individuals or businesses. You can work in technology or systems. You can manage projects or people. There are myriads of roles in financial services. But most importantly, you can have an impact on the well-being of Canadians through the sound management of their financials. So without further ado, I'd like to get started, but first of all, I have a few housekeeping items. So today's webinar is being recorded. Any financial ratings, financial reporting, analysis, projections, or other observations constituting part of this webinar are statements of opinion and not statements of fact and or recommendations to purchase, sell, or hold any securities. We ask that no one record the session without Moody's explicit written permission. And lastly, no one has permission to record any of the panelists or any of the invitees, the speakers or the attendees or their questions. All of you are currently on mute. If you have a question, please type it in the Q&A box at the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. So I'd like to introduce John Pappas. John will be introducing our panelists and hosting the session. So John is a Senior Director of Business Development and responsible for CSI's B2B strategy. He's been in the financial services industry for 25 years and occupied several roles, so he can speak quite freely about a lot of the things he's done in financial services. He's been a portfolio manager, a senior account executive, he's been an advisor in private banking, and an economist. In his spare time, he is a professional musician. So without further ado, I'll turn the session over to John Pappas.
Thank you, Marie. That was a very nice introduction. I appreciate that. Thank you. I'd like to welcome all the participants to today's session. So good afternoon for everyone who is on Eastern Time, and good morning or good evening for anybody who is joining us from a different time zone. I'd like to spend a minute and introduce our panelists for today. On your screen, from middle to right, joining us from RBC Wealth today is Natasha Savard, who is Vice President and Head of Training and Development. Additionally, from RBC, we have Yuste Sangalete, who is a manager at RBC and on campus at York University. And finally, we have Dylan Wilson joining us from White LeBlanc Wealth Planners. Dylan is a financial planner and associate portfolio manager and a Seneca graduate. The format for today's webinar will essentially be two rounds of individual questions for each of the panelists, at which point we will get to a third question that will be opened up to all the panelists. And then finally, I will ask a question of Marie, who is our host for today. All going well, we should be wrapped up all of the panelist questions somewhere between 12:40 and 12:45, at which point we will open things up to general Q&A for all the participants who are joining us today. To ask a question, you will notice at the bottom of your Zoom screen there is a Q&A button. Please click on that and ask your question as we go through the session, and I will try and get to as many of them as possible. On that note, we'll move to the next slide. And the first question is for Natasha. Natasha, what is the structure of the Canadian financial industry, and can you walk us through that, please?
Sure. Thank you very much, John, and thank you everyone for joining today. So this is a big question to answer. It's a very, very big industry, the financial industry. And I think, you know, I would probably start by saying there's typically, you know, the extremes of, you know, I know about the banking or I know about capital markets. And I think what I want to highlight today is that there's just so much in between all of that. There are so many lines of business. There are so many specializations, whether it's in banking or in a capital markets firm or a wealth firm that I represent. You know, there's so much to get to know. So without getting into too much detail today, I'll just give you some highlights. And I'm going to use RBC because we're well represented here today and I'm a little bit biased. If you take a company like RBC, for example, we're about 87,000 employees across the globe in all of our different lines of businesses. That's a very large organization, and that means we represent a number of different areas. So yes, we've got banking under the Royal Bank of Canada, probably the majority of our employees who work under something like personal and commercial banking. So that might be like our client service representatives or our account managers that are in retail branches. So the people that if you walked into an RBC branch, you would get to interact with. So, you've got that banking part. You've also got a number of people, thousands of people behind the scenes that are not in the branch, but they are supporting you as a client or our employees who are working at supporting our clients face to face. So our head office roles also represent a large part of the banking or the financial industry. I am a part of Wealth Management Canada, which is made up of RBC Dominion Securities, so our investment advisor firms, and PH&N, which are our investment counselor firms. So I'll use them as an example as well, because that might help understand the securities firms a little bit more. So in PH&N or in RBC Dominion Securities, you've got an investment advisor or investment counselor, and they represent or they work directly with private clients. So that might be a family or a business owner, and they're helping to manage their wealth. They are helping to manage their portfolio of wealth, obviously. They're doing financial planning or other wealth management work with them, client service, trading, all those different aspects. And they've got teams of people who work with them. So we've got thousands of people just in RBC Dominion Securities, a lot of 1,900 advisors, and the rest of those individuals are people who are helping them on their teams. So a ton of different roles and opportunities, and I think what I would probably want to summarize here and say is just, do some homework and really start to think about what different roles exist. Do I want to be client-facing, or do I want to be in a head office type or a national office type of role where I'm supporting from a different perspective? And so maybe I'll leave it there, John, and kind of pass it on to our next presenter to answer a different question.
I do have one quick follow-on for you, Natasha. As you're very well aware, our organization, the Canadian Securities Institute, really helps in raising the level of education for a lot of people. And as new entrants come into the industry, often they're doing things like the Canadian Securities course or what have you in order to seek out employment. But we're just a piece of the puzzle. What are some of the other things that an organization like RBC would be interested in terms of potential new entrant candidates above and beyond education? Could you talk about that for a minute?
Absolutely. Yeah, I think, whether it's RBC or any other firm, at the end of the day, everything that we do is for the client. So client service or understanding client experience, understanding what a client needs from a financial provider is really important. And how you're going to get that early on in your career, it could be any experience in a service type of industry. So you're working in retail, you're working in a service industry like a restaurant, and you're getting that experience working with people. You start to understand what people need, how people want to interact with others. And I think that, for me anyways, is a really important skill to learn early on, and that's something that will always serve you well. Because the client is ultimately, the core of everything that we're doing.
Oh, that's perfect. That's perfect. So customer engagement experience, people skills, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Perfect. Thank you very much. Let's move on to the next question. This question is for Yusei. Yusei, the question is, what are the career opportunities available for students right after graduation?
Thank you so much, John. So just to start off, the short answer, there are a lot of opportunities based on experience and education. So let's start off with the utmost entry-level position, a client advisor, as we call them at RBC. They're also known as a client service representative, or also known as a teller. You do not need any licensing to get to that stage. Then going into a banking advisor at RBC, or a universal banker, or a financial service representative, if you've been at the institutions long enough, that is another step, and that's where you may need your investment funds in Canada course. Then there are investment specialists, financial planners. We also have advice center, which is basically the call center, and there are various roles there. I want to tell you a little bit about my experience, and maybe that'll help others as well. I started my career at RBC about 7 years ago, never had any banking experience before. There are two ways of getting into the bank. If you have a wholesome career path and you know you want to get into the bank, maybe doing your courses will help you. And by courses, I mean the investment funds course in Canada. That really helped me get my mutual fund licensing, and that is what is required for entry-level sales roles. So that's the banking advisor, the financial service rep. And for myself, because I never had that experience of banking or I didn't do my courses, the bank did pay for my education, which is phenomenal. But I would say, if you do want to get a little bit more bang for your buck, if you do come in prepared and have these courses ready for you, you really do look like a better candidate coming in. I know that a lot of the time students come in and they ask, and actually we'll get to that question later on, but you know, students come in and they ask these questions, and I would definitely recommend that. Another thing that I would like to point out from Natasha's point of view, which is, you know, getting that experience, having confidence. I think confidence is the best indicator for success. And what I mean by that is getting that experience, talking to individuals, because at the end of the day, we can teach you everything at the bank. We can teach you how to, you know, discuss and give advice to our clients. But what's really needed is, can you have that interpersonal skills? And you gain those interpersonal skills by getting that experience. I'd like to finish off this question by just really talking about being qualified versus experienced. And qualified meaning taking these courses, but experience really just means handling situations. I think volunteering is super, super key. Currently right now, even though I'm working full-time, I love to volunteer with YES, which is Youth Employment Services, TRIAC, which is helping immigrants, and also Junior Achievement. Sorry, I don't know why I had a little laugh, but Junior Achievement. And it's really helping youth with financial literacy. So that experience of me, you know, presenting and talking to youth is really going to help me further on my path as well. Thanks, John.
Thank you, Eustace. Just a quick follow-on. I know we're talking a lot about people who are new entrants into the industry, perhaps, you know, graduates from universities and colleges. Would you suggest any kind of advice for perhaps maybe newcomers to Canada who maybe have experience in banking or the investment area, but in other countries, and they're seeking employment here? Maybe just quickly highlight maybe what that differential might be and how people should think about that.
Absolutely. Experience is experience, but like we mentioned before, it's qualified experience. So you have that back home, which is phenomenal, but we really want to see how you stand out and communicate in Canada. So gaining that experience could, once again, be volunteering, could be that retail service job. How are you communicating with, you know, in your environment? Because environments are different everywhere else. We can teach you those things again. And I have a great example. I have an individual that I did train, and she had that opportunity. She came in from a different country. She was a branch manager at back home. And when she came here, she went entry level. And it could be just personal choice. She wanted to really get into the industry and just find out. But if she gained a little bit more customer service experience, she would have probably skip that entry level and really was able to get further on in her career.
Thank you. That's great advice. Perfect. Let's move on to the next question here. Dylan, can you hear us okay? Or is your, everything's good on your end?
I got you loud and clear, John.
Okay, perfect, perfect. So the question for you, Dylan, is how can students entering the industry get started?
Yeah, so The best place to start, if you want to get licensed to sell investments, is with one of these two courses. So kind of in a nutshell, the Investment Funds in Canada course that allows you to sell mutual funds, whereas the CSC also allows you to sell mutual funds, but also individual stocks and most fixed income investments as well.
Perfect. Is there any advice that you would give in terms of how people might think of one course over the other, just in terms of possible career opportunity? I know you touched on it briefly here, but maybe you can extrapolate a little bit there.
Yeah. The best way to kind of determine it is what role you want to start in. So I know at the bank brokerages, you're just dealing in mutual funds, so that Investment Funds in Canada course is going to be sufficient. But if you do want to move into more holistic, advice giving or planning, you're going to want to be licensed to sell more and more different types of securities. So that's really where the CSC is going to come into play. It's a difficult question when you start your career, since part of the challenge is getting your foot in the door somewhere first. That's kind of where I would start is focus on, okay, where do I want to go in my career and what's going to help me get there faster? If you can achieve what you want to achieve with just the Investment Funds in Canada course, that's a good place to start. But if you do want to get licensed to sell stocks at some point in the future, then it could be beneficial to just start with the CSC to begin with.
That's great. What was your experience, Dylan, when you started off your career?
It's a great question. I mean, I could take you through kind of my career journey, and that might provide a little bit more insight there.
Oh, yes, please. Take a minute.
Yeah. So what I did was I started my career and my college experience back in 2010. As you mentioned at the beginning, I went to Seneca and I completed a bachelor's degree in financial services management. Got my first job in the industry as a co-op placement at BMO Nesbitt Burns, which is the full service brokerage arm of the Bank of Montreal. I was a cold caller there for an advisory team, and I actually did that for free as an unpaid internship. I took that position because I wanted to get my foot in the door at one of the big bank brokerages, and that was the way that I could do it. So while I was at Seneca, I actually completed the Investment Funds in Canada course and the CSC. At that time, I wasn't really aware of the overlap on the mutual fund side, so there's no need to do both. That was a mistake that I made when I was a student. When I graduated from Seneca, I went back to BMO, but actually on the investor line side. The role that I took there was called an investment specialist. So I accepted this position because I felt like it was an area of the bank that I could learn a ton. They also committed to investing in my education, which was a priority for me. So for those that don't know, the investor line is the discount brokerage arm of BMO, and what that means is that clients can basically go online and do their own trading. They don't get any advice from the bank. So my job there was to help clients with the system, answer general questions, input orders from people that didn't have a computer or that they couldn't put through from their end. So while I was at BMO, stuck with my educational journey. I completed the what's called a Conduct and Practices Handbook course, as well as the 30-day training program. That, along with the CSC, allowed me to become licensed as what's called an investment representative. So this registration allows you to accept unsolicited orders, but not provide investment advice. After that, and still with the bank, I completed the options licensing course and the derivatives fundamental course. These two courses has then allowed me to trade options, which are financial derivatives that are also traded on the securities exchanges. So after about a year, my time at BMO came to an end, and I took a position as a licensed assistant. I was what was then called Hollis Wealth, but we've now changed our name to IA Private Wealth. And I believe we're the largest independent non-bank-owned brokerage in the country. So if you're looking at going through and becoming an advisor or financial planner, I'd highly recommend you learn and research the difference between bank brokerages and independent firms. There's some key differences in how they're set up, and one might be better suited for your career path over the other. So while with IA Private Wealth, my title changed many times over the years. So started as a licensed assistant, moved to an associated investment advisor, then investment advisor, added insurance licensing to become an insurance advisor, and now my title is a financial planner and associate portfolio manager. So kind of moving through the framework there, to go from in what's called an IR, or investment representative, that's the registration where you can't give advice. I then completed a course called the Wealth Management Essentials, as well as a 90-day training program. And that allowed me to upgrade my registration to what's called a registered representative. So that's what you need to be registered with IIROC if you want to provide advice to clients. In 2018, I completed my what's called a CFP, Certified Financial Planner designation. And this is really the premier designation for financial planners in Canada. To get that, you have to go through an organization called FP Canada, complete a financial planning supplement course, two exams, and a capstone. That might have changed since I did it, but that was the path that I did when I went through the process. And that year, I also got my insurance licensing, which consists of a couple of courses as well. Finally, this year, I received my Chartered Investment Management Manager designation, That requires two courses, which is the Advanced Investment Strategies and Portfolio Management Techniques. So this is the designation where I was able to upgrade my registration to what it is today, a portfolio manager. We call it a PM in the business. And this is somebody who can manage clients' assets on a discretionary basis. So what that means is that I don't need to phone my clients to receive confirmation to implement recommendations. The benefit here is that it allows me to do my job much more effectively and efficiently, because instead of having to call 100 clients of mine, if I do want to make a change in their portfolios, I can do it for everybody at the same time. And it allows me to spend my time doing things that are value add for people instead of doing administrative tasks. And then the next steps for me kind of going forward, as I think education is a lifelong journey, I'm going to be doing what's called a CLU, or a Chartered Life Underwriter designation, which is more on the insurance side, but it focuses on estate planning.
That's quite the journey, Dylan, I must say. That is absolutely fantastic. I'm actually amazed that you found time to work in all of that. No, I'm just kidding. I'm sure you manage your life accordingly well, but you're certainly set up to work in a number of different areas as you go forward through time. And of course, adding a CLU is just going to open up more doors for you, I would imagine. So thank you very much for that response. The next question actually was me asking you to share your journey. So I think you've answered that question quite well. So we'll move on to the next question beyond this one. And this question is for Eustay. What are some common questions you receive from students?
Thanks, John. So I think the biggest one is, I want to work at a bank and where do I start? So typically I like to follow up with that question and say, what do you want to do? Right? Because we do have so many different positions that we can talk about. And once again, we talked about that as my first question, but it's all about time frame and what you're interested in. And why I say by time frame is, like I said, I've been at the bank for 7 years. I did move up a couple notches, but it's about what your end goal is. And wonderful leaders have always told me, think of your two steps ahead. And I think Dylan kind of talked about that, you know, this is what he wants to do. So it's really having that career path for yourself. And you might not know where to start, and that's okay. I know that, CSI has this great roadmap, career map that we're going to talk about a little bit later on as well. But really just spending that time and thinking about what you want to do. The other thing is also it's based on education experience. So if I'm talking to someone that just finished a Bachelor of Arts in business, maybe, I would tell them, if you really want to get your feet wet, let's go into an entry-level role. But let's just say you had your MBA in business. You don't want to start with an entry-level position, and that's totally understandable. So really looking at things like Natasha mentioned at the beginning, people want to get into capital markets. Start by also networking, understanding what you're looking for. Network, network, network. You know, have coffee chats, 10 webinars like this. attend advice events that I host all the time or other people in the organization. Get yourself out there and get yourself to stick. And what I mean by that is engage. Don't just attend and say, oh, that was a cool event. I'm just going to keep that in the my little noggin. No, share your thoughts. You know, go on LinkedIn. Be excited about it like I am. You know, I have a big, bubbly personality. But sometimes you can't reflect that, so you have to reflect it in different ways. So knowledge is power. Share your knowledge. Share your excitement. And other people will be reflected by that as well.
That's excellent advice, Yuste. I think the message there is get yourself noticed as much as possible. Break away from the pack, if you will. So that's definitely good advice. We'll move on to the next question here. This is for Natasha. Natasha, what are some gaps in expectations before and after joining the Canadian financial services industry?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think we've touched on a couple of these already, but a few things maybe I'll remind the audience of, that finance is just one thing and everyone's journey is very different. So, you know, if you've listened to Dylan's career path, Yuste's career path, mine is also, you know, very different. It's just understanding that you could work in finance without being someone who has a finance or economics degree and who really wants to get into the nitty-gritty of finance. Capital markets, investment banking, when I speak to interns or new graduates from university business schools, those are the two things I hear over and over. You know, I want to work in capital markets. I want to be an investment banker. I think that's what the business schools talk about. I don't think they talk about any of the other areas, to be honest. And there's so many really interesting, rewarding areas of finance that I think you can get into that are looking for a very different skill set or a different background or different talents. I'll use my own personal story. I landed in the financial service industry kind of by accident. My neighbor was an investment advisor when I was in university, and so he hired me part-time after school. I have no interest in finance whatsoever. It's not my natural ability, but I've built this incredible 20-year career at RBC using the talents that I have. People management and people are two, you know, those are the things that I love, and those are the things that I'm able to do for a huge organization like RBC that values that diversity of talent. So don't just assume it's one thing or the other. I think if you love working with people, I mentioned earlier, our clients are the base, the core of everything that we all do. If you love working with people, maybe working with clients is the right job for you. So you need people skills. You need to be somebody like you stay with a personality where you want to engage with this person. You want to have conversations with them. You want to build trust or with them and work with them. So I think that's, you know, something to consider. How do you tap into those natural qualities and background experiences that you have to get into the industry? I would say, you know, I'm just kind of checking the Q&A as well. I think we've talked about the CSC or the other courses. They're all really important, but I don't want you to think that just because you've done your CSC, you're going to get a foot in the door. So do your research. Make sure that, you know, you kind of have a sense of where you want to start out before you start doing those courses. You know, if you do your CSC and your CPH and you don't get a job where you're going to get licensed, those courses do expire. It's a 3-year expiration period, but that's really important for you to remember, because I would hate for you to do them too far in advance and then have to redo one or all of them at some point when you actually do get your foot in the door. And then my last little thing, John, maybe that I'll touch on is there's no perfect clear career path necessarily. There might be in very specific industries or very specific areas, but pick a place. Pick a place that seems to fit for you. And Dylan mentioned this as well. Do your research about the kind of firm you want to work at. RBC is an incredible company to work for. I've been here for 20 plus years. I love it. I have no desire to go anywhere else, but it's a specific culture. It's a specific type of place to work. And those smaller boutique firms might fit your personality a little bit better. So you just want to make sure that you're going to invest in working at a place that feels right for you and that's going to give you the right kinds of opportunities. And then you're going to figure your way out or figure your way through, I should say, as you gain that experience. So maybe I'll stop there, John, and pass it back over.
I think I'd like to ask you one additional question, Natasha, because I'm seeing a lot of questions coming up in the Q&A here, and there's some subtle differences and nuances between the types of groups or demographics that are, you know, seeking work in the financial services industry. You know, you've got students who are graduating or going to be recent graduates of universities or colleges looking for opportunities as new entrants. You have maybe possible midlife career changers, people who are moving from one industry to another. And then there's this third very prominent group, which often tends to be new immigrants coming to Canada, but they're not necessarily inexperienced. They're coming to Canada having worked perhaps, you know, partially or maybe half their adult life as professionals in financial services. Are there any key differences in those groups in terms of how they may go about engaging with financial institutions and what sort of differences they might experience based on that? Because I can only imagine that, you know, somebody who's new to Canada, for example, that has 20 years of banking experience is going to interface with a financial institution in a different way than, say, a student who's graduating from university. I wonder if you might highlight very quickly maybe some of those differences, at least how you see them on your side.
Mm-hmm. So this will just be my perspective and some of my experiences. So by no means is this the only way, but I think, you know, you've got to set your expectations realistically. There's a lot to learn, whether you're getting into, you know, the RBC Dominion Securities, which is what I'm most familiar with, or you're getting into banking. There's a steep learning curve, maybe steeper in some roles than others. So being open to having some time to learn those roles, even just listening to Dylan's career path, you know, he didn't start where he was. He started as an intern. He got that education. He got the experience. So sometimes, you know, I feel like sometimes we want to skip some of those steps and just get ahead a little bit further. The reality is the Canadian banking industry or finance industry is going to be a little bit different than it would be in the U.S. or in other countries. So you've got to take the time to learn and get your foot in the door and build your networks and your connections on these platforms as well. I think for university students as well, you know, there's tons of places you can start. You stay kind of covered some of those key starting points. And I think if you're willing to get in there and just learn, you know, there's room and opportunity for everyone. And different companies will definitely be really supportive on the educational front, whether it's giving you a couple days away to go study or financially supporting the education that you need. So it's, again, I think a lot of it comes down to research, though. Like, where do I really want to start? Where am I trying to get to? And taking those steps. Mm-hmm. So I hope that helps.
That's great. Thank you for that. As a matter of fact, the next question is just general advice to students, but I'll broaden that question to both Dylan and Yuste, which was my previous question, around not just students, but perhaps midlife career changers and perhaps even new immigrants to Canada. Any nuances or advice that you might share with our participants today? I'll ask Yuste to jump in here.
Yeah, absolutely. Just like Natasha mentioned, it's all about the way you network, right? You know, back home, it might be a different way and a career path for you. I have another example of a branch manager that came in and, you know, she was from Dubai and she's had multitudes of years of experience, but she still started off entry level. She was a branch manager back home, but she still found it valuable to do all these roles. And as soon as you get it, it's like, check, I'm good. Now it's on to the next. It's on to the next. Because at times it's just gaining that experience because there is some slight differences. So for that newcomer, don't be discouraged. It's very understandable. Lots of things are changing. You know, add the pandemic to it. You know, that there's that extra level of complexity. But you will get there within time. And, you know, me as a millennial, I also at times struggle with just wanting to keep moving up in the industry and wanting to be the best. But it's time and place. And if you put that energy towards being amazing at what you do, you will get there. I know we're talking to a lot of folks that are probably also struggling to even just get into that market of getting into the roles. So what I mean to start off by saying is get yourself to network. It's the end all and be all, because the more that you apply to, the more chances you're going to be getting into something. But you should be really putting in your energy and focusing on a couple positions, not all the positions. Because then again, you're not really going to be tailored to that role because you might not be interested in it. You just applied for it because you really wanted to get in. But just, you know, take some time and focusing on yourself.
That's great. Thank you, Yuste. I'll pose the same question to Dylan. As a matter of fact, could we roll to the next slide as we're working on this question here? So Dylan, the question was, what advice would you give to current students? But as I mentioned before, I would also expand that to perhaps talking to midlife career changers or perhaps new immigrants to Canada. Again, there's some nuances between how to approach in either case, but perhaps you can make a comment on one or two of those.
Yeah, I mean, my advice would be, I mean, you got to be prepared to put in the hard work. I can tell you a little bit of a story. I don't know how much this would apply to the midlife career change just because of some of the time commitment to that. But I mean, me starting as an unpaid intern, that was a position that pretty much every other student at Seneca passed over because it was unpaid. And I realized it was with a firm that I wanted to be at long term at the time. And that was 10-hour days, making cold calls and 100 plus people a day telling me to bug off. But I understood at the time that that wasn't the end goal and that this was probably going to be a stepping stone. And that's what it ended up to be. So when I did graduate and I did apply back to BMO for a different role at a different line of business, they had known that I had that experience, right? So I think my resume probably went to the top of the pile there and they ended up accepting me. But the hard road didn't really end there for me at the time, and I still do live downtown Toronto, and that role at Investor Line was in Meadowvale, which is in the far west corner of Mississauga, and as a new graduate, I wasn't driving, so that was an hour and a half on the bus each way, so that's a three-hour commute, and not a lot of people are willing to do that. But once again, I knew that that was going to be kind of my foot in the door. Finally making some income, and I was really going to learn about all the different aspects of the business for my NCOL to become an investment advisor. And even my colleagues at InvestorLine at the time, I'm still connected with many of them. Some of them have moved on to big multinationals to work in compliance. Others are working for capital markets in the research and investment banking side. So just because that original kind of entry-level role might not be the end goal, if you have the kind of the drive and the will and the time to be able to make that investment in yourself, then most likely can set you up for what you want to do in the future.
Very good. Any other sort of last comments on this particular question? Anything any of you would like to add?
Don, I might add something, just a piece of advice that I like to share with either interns that are working with me or that approach me. Most companies today post all of their job postings online. So you've got access to a very vast job bank resource. And what I would suggest is even if you're not in a position today to be applying for those jobs, go through those job banks and just read those job descriptions. Try to understand what kinds of jobs are out there, whether it's in technology, whether I like sales, client service, maybe it's a specific city that I'm limited to. Try to understand what that job is about. What is it that I love about those? Some things will stick out to you and you might build yourself a list of like, this is a really interesting, you know, I really tend to gravitate towards these kinds of things, or I have no idea what these things are, so I'm gonna go do some research and figure out what those things actually mean. And you know, even if management is something that you think, I really like this area and I'd love to be a manager in that area, build yourself a skills or a gap analysis from that perspective. These jobs that I really tend to like are asking for these types of skills or qualifications or licensing requirements. So these are the things I should be pursuing as I'm getting ready to enter that job market. And I think that really gives you some good perspective and gives you a good starting ground too when you're networking or you're asking for a mentor's time to have some time with them to learn something. You've got a good set of questions that you can go in and ask them.
That's great.
Actually, I'd like to add as well, if that's okay.
Yes.
I never did business. I never studied business, finance. I loved marketing, but I just never went into it. I graduated with a Bachelor of Human Rights. So yes, I'm fighting for the people and all the advice to help clients, but it has nothing to do with that. So kind of going back to the midlife crisis, changing, you know, careers, you could definitely get into banking, even if you'd like to change your career. And just to Natasha's point, you know, if you don't know what you want to do, start entry level, and then you have that job bank, and you'll be able to, you know, twist and turn, change, you know, change your career path. But it's just kind of getting your feet wet and just really understanding what you want to do. So you can't go wrong with customer service, dealing with people, and that's how you enter it. I once heard that an astronaut was working for RBC, like crazy, like what kind of stuff. You never would think that you would hear that kind of stuff, but it's true. Like, you could really start any career path. Maybe you're close to retirement and you wanted to start it. Maybe you're just entry level and you're just graduating. So don't be shy. You know, once again, network. I'm going to go back to, I'm the networking queen. Go back to networking, talking to other people, and seeing if it's worth your time to invest.
That's great. Thank you. Dylan, any last thoughts on this piece?
No, I think that's it on the advice that I could provide in my story.
That's perfect. Thank you very much. I think at this point, I have a question to pose to Marie. There you are. Marie, so the question for you at this point is, focusing back on the industry, how does the Canadian Securities Institute help prepare students for roles in the financial services industry?
Great, John. As you know, the Canadian Securities Institute has been in business since 1970, and we have been providing education to students along their journey. We like to think of ourselves as people who are accompanying people through their career. So they start a career, they get their first licensing course, and then, as you heard Dylan's story, or Natasha's story, or just a story, different people have different paths depending on where you want to go. And so we have been providing education for people. And if you think about the industry is very regulated because the industry is handling people's money, handling people's business money. And so governments want to make sure, and regulators want to make sure, that this is being done properly. So a lot of what we do has to do with making sure that people meet proficiency requirements. Those requirements are set by regulators. We will set the requirements. And then financial institutions are really looking for people that are qualified so that they are meeting their compliance requirements, but also that they can serve their clients really well. And I think a lot of what our panelists had to talk about today was how you serve clients, how you're able to pick up on their needs, how you're able to match their needs with financial products and services and increase and improve their well-being. So on the financial services side, the institution side, it's really important for them to have people who are educated. And on the side of individuals who are working in the financial services industry, they're looking for a career path. They're looking for places to go. And again, you've heard the different stories of people going through their career path. And so there are many, many, many jobs that you can do. If you turn to the next slide, we have on our website a career map. And you can find it at csi.ca/career map. And really, it's a career map of many of the careers, and it's not even exhaustive, of many of the careers that you can get in financial services. And if you click on any one of those circles, you'll find information about the career, about the income that you can make, about the requirements, the course requirements that you have, so that you're well set up in order to get into a career in financial services. So just a look at our career map will give you an idea of the myriad of employment possibilities in the banks that you can take. And so we like to think of ourselves as people that are holding your hand through your career from beginning to end.
Excellent. Marie, there's a few questions here, and it's a little more detailed, but perhaps you can help answer that. There's a lot of people who are asking questions around the Canadian Securities course, and specifically the CPH. Should they be doing the CPH or not after they do the Canadian Securities course?
I think what you do after the Canadian Securities course really depends on what you want to do in your career. And very often, I think people will wait until they get into their career in financial services to the DPA, the CPH, because you want to make sure that you are with an employer in order to start your career and make sure that you have the courses you need and then the experience and also the link to an employer to make that useful. So some people will get into do a CSC and then go on into financial planning. Some people will go on into investment management. Some people will go into portfolio management. So there's many various careers you can take from the moment you've got the CSC. So the CPH is one of them, but that's really if you want to be in the brokerage side and you want to go on that path to make sure that you have all the license requirements in order to be an investment advisor.
Perfect. Perfect. Thanks for that explanation. So that brings us really to the end of the formal questions, if you will. I think what I'd like to do at this point in reviewing a lot of the questions that have come in over the last 45 minutes is maybe take the next 10 minutes. And I'd like to ask all the panelists to sort of engage in a roundtable here. We've talked a lot about people who are seeking opportunities in the financial services industry, whether they're new entrants into the industry as graduates from colleges and universities, whether they're new to Canada and they're seeking a role in the business, or perhaps people like midlife career changers or just general career changers to begin with. But I think I want to focus in on, because we haven't really touched on it too much, is let's make the assumption that you're already in the financial services industry. What is the next aspect for people to grow their careers above and beyond entering the industry? And what advice would you have for people who are looking for career growth as opposed to actually seeking out brand new employment? I wonder if we could just sort of engage in a bit of a roundtable discussion around that for a couple of minutes. Natasha, perhaps I'll ask you to go first on this one.
Okay, so very, very good, very broad question. So, I think being within a company already like RBC, I think you've got access to networking. You know, to Eustace's point, networking is going to be very important for you as you're growing in your career. So I think once you're in somewhere, it's really, leveraging the people that you have access to, whether it's for a coffee chat or, could you mentor me? I'm interested in learning a bit more, getting into the area that you're in. The designations and the courses, I think, those are going to be important in certain areas, but, I don't know if I'll get into that because I think it's going to be very specific to the exact role that you're looking to pursue. I don't think there's any better way than networking. You can definitely have access to the job banks, but I'm pretty sure, the majority of those are public anyways, so it's not giving you that much of an advantage. I think your advantage is really, being there in that industry. And then, of course, having that industry experience. So if you're looking, if the experience that you're, or sorry, the opportunity you're looking for is not offered where you're at, if that's not an option for you, sometimes, you do have to kind of move around a little bit and explore other firms, other industries, whether it's, I'm going to go to a bigger firm or I'm going to, go to somewhere a little bit smaller. Those are really important considerations as well.
Very good. Dylan, you've illustrated an ongoing element in career growth, largely through education, but I'm sure through experience as well. Maybe you could talk about, some advice around that and how people should think about where they want to go next and the types of things that they should consider when they're looking to make a move within the context of an already existing career.
Yeah, my advice would just be have willingness to pivot. When I started my career, I was only looking at the banks, especially as a Canadian perspective. We're kind of taught from a young age that the banks are these, big, strong, financially sound firms, and Canadians in general kind of look up to them. So that's where I started my career. I wanted to work for one of the big five. But then after I kind of got in there and learned a little bit more about the industry and where I wanted to take my career and my future business that I was thinking about, pivoting to the independent side actually made more sense for me. 'Cause the difference between working for a bank-owned brokerage versus an independent brokerage is really the employment model. So
The bank owned brokerages has an investment advisor. You're typically an employee of that bank. But on the independent side, the firm that you work with is actually your partner. So you're not an employee, you're running your own business. And that's really what I wanted to do, is kind of mend those two passions of mine of you know, personal finance and entrepreneurship. And that independent side actually allowed me to do that. But that's not a path that I was originally aware of. I learned that kind of getting into the industry and talking to people. And then when I wanted to kind of break away from my entry level role, meeting with different teams from different institutions, I learned about that path. And then it happened again. I mean, once I did become an investment advisor, I learned about becoming a portfolio manager, which was, you know, an increased level of licensing, which gives you some additional abilities that your traditional advisor doesn't have. And I realized, you know, there's some more courses and proficiency requirements that I need to complete in order to get there. So that would be my advice: be willing to be flexible, kind of learn as you go. And then, like the other two panelists said, I mean, just kind of, you know, networking with individuals to learn, you know, what else is out there, and then develop your path to get there.
Makes sense. It sounds as though there's a lot of details to think about when you're, say, targeting a specific kind of position that you would like to work in from one to the next. And it sounds like that's been your experience, is that as you've moved into newer positions because of education and experience, you've discovered that there's even more. It's kind of like peeling back the layers of the onion, if you will, if I could make that analogy. Yuste, any advice in this capacity?
Absolutely. I would say that I never thought banking, and once I got here, I still was doubtful, didn't know if I wanted to stay here, was once again an entry level. But once I got here, I had the really, really great managers that really believed in me and knew that I could keep going on. So if you're that lucky and you have that ability, you know, keep talking about what your career path may look like and may, like, what you want to do. And then they may, once again, networking, pass on that knowledge or maybe introduce you to other people. Meeting Dylan and Natasha, I've learned so much from them already as well. So, you know, attending these types of sessions to kind of get to know more people. I just, myself, I've taken courses. I know that these things are out there, but until you kind of take and, like Dylan said, pivot and learn and see if you might be interested in those things, that's when you're really going to find out more about yourself, if you even have that in you. And it's all about, like the last slide, you know, your soft skills. You will be able to pass on those things. You just have to have that leap of faith. And the more that you talk about it, you know, maybe like today, I have a fear. Maybe I never thought about, you know, taking Dylan's career path, but that might be for me. So stepping back, reevaluating yourself, and taking that leap if you need to.
Makes sense. So, apart from, you know, gaining experience in the industry, additional education, whether it's, you know, at an entry level or further on down, depending on where you want to go, what sort of value do you put on internal networking? We talked a lot about external networking, but what about internal networking?
I would definitely say internal networking would be super, super key. So it would just really involve setting yourself goals. Like you say, you know, I want to lose 10 pounds in a month. Let's just say that's a goal. Same thing with your career path. I need to do 10 coffee shots this month because I want to get to where I have to be. So, you know, or whenever you're having that one major coffee chat, you say, you know what, John, I would really love it if you can give me one other person's name I can reach out to. So that's effective networking within the organization as well.
Yeah, that's great. Marie, I'll give you a final word on this question. Any last bit of advice here before I pass this back to you?
Well, I think there's lots of opportunities to go in lots of different directions. And I think if you take some of the advice that you're hearing, network internally, network externally, look at job descriptions, look at the career site, talk to other people in the industry, go into your bank and talk to people who are in the bank about their career. People love to talk about, you know, what they've done, how they've gotten there. You've got today three examples of people who have come into the industry and have taken very different paths, gone different directions, and work in different institutions. So I think it's a matter of starting with a session like this, but also getting educated, if you're in a college or and you're working with many of the professors, a number of the people who work in the college can also provide you advice. Your counselors, career counselors in the colleges and universities will be able to offer you advice as well, just you works as well in one of the universities. So there's a lot of resources, and a lot of the financial institutions come into the universities and recruit, and so look out for that as well. So lots of opportunities to go in lots of different directions.
Yes, definitely. So we're just at 5 minutes to the top of the hour. I guess we can do some quick summarizing here and maybe some last few words. Does anybody have any last bits of ideas, information, advice that they'd like to add before we sign off?
Maybe there's a few questions here, John, around the difference between the IFC and the CSC. It's maybe not abundantly clear for people. I think if you do the Investment Funds in Canada course, you are learning how to sell mutual funds, which can be sold through branches. And one of the questions, I believe, was, is that good enough to get into the branch? That's a very good start, and you'll have lots of opportunity to do other courses thereafter. But you've got a good foundation. If you want to go further, if you want to be in the brokerage side, then you'll need your Canadian Securities course. So you don't have to do the two of them. If you want to have the both of them covered, often people start with the CSC and do the Canadian Securities course. But you can also start with Investment Funds in Canada, and then as you grow, add the CSC later on. So depending, again, on your path, you may never work in a brokerage, which means you wouldn't necessarily need the CSC. But it's very valuable, not only for careers in banking, but also for careers outside. Many firms will be looking for a CSC if you're working in the financial side of a business, in the investment side, investor relations, for example. So there's a lot of careers that are also available to you that are not in the financial services industry, or will allow you to go in and out of the financial services industry as you grow your career and your experience.
Yeah, so it ultimately depends on what you aspire to do. I think to your point, Marie, and Dylan also mentioned it earlier to some degree, is that, you know, if your intent is to work in branch banking, completing the Canadian Securities course would maybe be more than you need. However, at the same time, it also offers you a much broader view of the world, which may have a different kind of value altogether for you as you move through your career, even though you may ultimately not be a licensed advisor at some point down the road. So it really, I think, comes down to personal choice in many ways.
Yeah, I think another couple of questions we had was around, you know, if I'm working in, say, New Brunswick, or I'm working in Quebec, is there a difference? The licensing requirements are national, so no matter where you're working in the country, you can use any of these licenses to within the financial services industry. The banks are federally regulated, but some of their subsidiaries are provincially regulated, which means you may have some provincial requirements that are on top, but your basics are Canadian and pan-Canadian.
Yes, I think without getting into too much detail, I think the only differential potentially that we see is around financial planning.
Insurance, John, is also another area where Quebec has their own licensing.
Yes, correct. But you're right, Marie. In terms of licensing, as we see the world, it's pretty uniform across the country.
That's right.
Yeah.
I'm just seeing if there are any other quick questions that we can answer here. There are so many, and we will try and answer the questions individually so we can get back to you on some of the questions that you've asked. Picking up any, John?
There's a few questions here on maybe a quick highlight between roles in the industry that are commission-based versus non-commission-based, but effectively still providing advice. I wonder if we might contrast those really quickly here. In terms of roles, anybody who'd like to jump in?
I don't know if I'm an expert in this area. I don't know, Dylan, if you want to take this one, but I can give it a shot.
Yeah, I mean, what I was going to say just quickly, from a full-service brokerage standpoint, you have individual advisors and portfolio managers.
who are 100% commission. And on the flip side, they're going to have associates that work under them, and those individuals are primarily salary-based. So the difference between those two from the brokerage side is if you want to take on more of that sales responsibility, and then on the independent side, if you want to take on more of the business responsibility, then a commission role is probably what you want to look at. If you just want to focus on relationships and providing advice, and you don't want the headache of running a business or trying to build a business, then looking for more of an associate type salary role is probably a better fit for you.
All right, thank you everyone. So this, it's the top of the hour. This concludes our event. I'd like to thank Natasha and Justy and Dylan for joining the webinar, and for to John for hosting the webinar. You've really provided some interesting insights into the roles available in the industry and the paths to get there. For those who are listening, the recording of the session will be available shortly on csi.ca. If you have any additional questions, you can direct them to designations@csi.ca. And if you want to enroll in the CSC or the IFC, you're welcome to visit csi.ca/PSI, that's for post-secondary institutions, to sign up. So the replay of this event will be available shortly. Thank you for attending. Have a great day, and good luck on your path to a career in financial services.